All right. Hello again, everybody. Welcome to another exciting episode of The Tyranny of Dragons. Yes, this is my... And there it goes. This is the first official DD campaign released for 5th edition, Dungeons & Dragons. Lots of stuff has happened so far, and I am not doing particularly well right now, so we are going to just recap the very most recent things that have happened, which is they left Waterdeep tracking some cultists. They made it to this kind of workhouse, lumber camp type thing, or road camp type thing. Now they're there and they're trying to figure out where these goods are going from this work camp. The only thing that they know is that the goods get locked in this, storage room. One of the only locked rooms in this entire, complex. Yes. And they also recently found out that the cultists know that they're here, are not particularly fond of them, and are planning something. So, I think everything that happened thus far happened like really early in the morning, right? So it's, I think right now, the rest of you guys are waking up and, it's probably like mid morning at this point, like 10 o'clock ish.
Yeah. I got up pre-dawn and then the whole walrus thing happened at like just after dawn. Mm-hmm. So
you guys have had a little bit of time to kind of mull over, what Valdis told you, everything going on, and now you guys have what do you guys want to do? Right now you're all back in your room.
So, what do you all think?
Well, I don't think they can just come out and attack us in the open.
No, that'd be too obvious.
Exactly. Some of the workers don't seem to be in on it. At least, I don't think Colin was. Yeah, he seemed very honest to me. I don't know what everyone's problem with him was. And when Boulagog, when he attacked Valdis, he took him into a side route, into a side area. Valdis said, you know, there wasn't anyone else around to see it. If he wasn't, why would he take him someplace secluded if he wasn't worried about somebody seeing what was going on? He's trying to do it in secret. So I think staying secluded is probably dangerous for us. If they can attack us, you know, in our room, that might not arouse as much suspicion. If we're in the open, I don't think they can just come at us and attack all of us at once.
You want to go up to the bar, don't you?
Sorry?
You want to go up to the bar, don't you, Anna?
Well, it is out in the open.
What about you, Ollie?
I've never had this type of situation before, so I will do what I can to help when the situation comes.
All right, Lillian, you're the most recognizable one to them.
Yeah. I agree. We could be as open as the public as we could be. I mean, for my usually, I mean, we were there at Greenland, but usually they don't want open combat.
Fair. They may not try and take our lives, is what I'm fearing. They may do something more treacherous.
Something like magic, like always. Do I know? Yeah, I mean,
what do you think? Do we just open the door and walk to the bar in confidence and pride, or...
I mean, that's what I'm thinking.
Unless Valdis wants to cast Locate Object, and I look at Valdis, who's been very, very quiet.
He seems really preoccupied with something, to the point where you get the idea that he's probably not going to be much help for the next couple hours.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
So, want to get breakfast, I guess?
Yeah.
I'm hungry. You go get breakfast.
Anna?
I could use something to eat.
All right. Before we go, just while they're getting their things, I check the door for traps.
All right, make me an investigation check.
That is a... We got a bonus to it. Yeah, so 20 total.
It looks safe.
All right. I open it.
I need a dexterity saving throw. I'm kidding. door opens. And again, at this point, most of this... most of this roadhouse is pretty bustling. You have the working crews have already left, but you have more wagons that are coming in. From the night before, they weren't able to get the entire set of wagons from your guys' caravan done the night before. So you have the crews that live at the roadhouse and unload items and stuff like that. They're unloading more wagons. The cleaning staff and the people that are working in the stables and everything, like the whole place is relatively busy. Not quite as busy as when I think, Anna, you came out like real early in the morning to talk with Corin, right? Or Colin.
Yes.
So it was a little bit busier and hectic, more hectic then, because the road workers and everything was still there. Now it's died down a little bit, but there really isn't anyone asleep anymore. Like, you guys are the last people to come out of your rooms.
All right.
So what would you like to do?
I'm just kind of, because I'm assuming you're all heading upstairs to get something to eat.
Yes. Yeah. And kind of looking around, seeing if anybody has their eye on us.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yes. Kind of covertly.
Roll me a perception check.
Okay. Eleven.
Kind of glancing around, there's a little bit too much activity for you to tell. There are a lot of people that kind of glance in your direction when you guys come out the door, but that's not an uncommon thing to happen. Because there's been no movement from that area of the roadhouse in a little while. So, you know, movement happens, a lot of people look over.
I was going to do the same thing, but since I knew they were watching me earlier, I want to see if more are watching me now. Now.
Definitely.
Okay. Go ahead and roll me a perception check.
11 as well.
as you look around, you're actually having a really hard time finding anyone that you remember was a cultist. The cultists here aren't wearing their cultist garbs or their masks or anything like that. They're wearing regular peasant clothing. So unless you recognize their face, you can't really tell who's a cultist and who's not. And none of the people wandering around seem particularly familiar to you. Like, a lot of them seem familiar because you spent, you know, 10 days with them. But as far as finding one that you're like, wait a minute, that was a cultist, you got nothing.
All right.
So you guys have come out. You're on the ground floor. You're kind of forced, until you kind of make a decision on where you're going, you're kind of forced to stand, like, up against the wall next to the door to your room. Simply because there's a lot of activity happening in the middle of the, what's it called? The courtyard? Man, my brain is just fried. Because they're unloading wagons and stuff like that. So you really, unless you're moving quickly and are staying out of the way, you can't really, like, hang around the center of the courtyard. There's too much activity going on.
All right.
So what do you guys want to do? You're still, right now, you're still right outside your door. Okay. So Lillian starts off kind of dodging past people carrying boxes and stuff like that. Gets across the courtyard and starts heading up the stairs to the kind of makeshift galley.
I'll follow.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll do the same. Yeah.
Okay. So you guys move kind of as a group. Across, you come up to the galley. You notice, Anna specifically, you recognize, there's a lot less people in here than there were before. Before, there was almost nowhere to sit. It was really, really loud and just people running around. Now, it's by no means empty. Like, it's still relatively full, but there are empty tables, there are empty chairs and things like that. Significantly easier to go down. You do notice that most of the food that was out is gone. Like, you don't smell, like, the overwhelming smell of fresh baked bread and, you know, cooked meats and stuff like that. There's still a little bit, but you're thinking, like, breakfast is about to end.
Okay.
Well, let's get what we can.
So you guys are now standing in the door to the, you know, makeshift canteen. It's about, let's say, half full. So probably about, you know, 30-some-odd people in there already. A few of them look over at you as soon as you come in. Other ones don't even bother. What do you all want to do?
I say we find a table right in the middle of the room.
Sure.
Okay. So, not very difficult to find. Most of the tables in the middle of the room have at least one person sitting at them, but they're kind of, they're long tables. They seat like easily seat eight people. So you're able to find one where you guys can basically take half the table. As soon as you sit down, a barmaid comes over and, you know, goes, "Okay, what you want?"
Do you have coffee?
Do we have what?
I'll just take some toast, please.
Right, we've got bread, we've got cold meat, and we've got drinks.
I will take some bread, please.
Right, what about the rest of you?
Bread as well, and meat.
Right, anything else?
Have some bread as well.
All right, a bunch of bread. That'll be a copper when I come back. She walks away. And halfway back to the kitchen. She stops, turns around, each, and then walks, continues walking. Go ahead and everybody roll me insight checks.
Sure. Nine.
Okay. Anna?
No, 19.
Not bad at all. Ollie?
20, not natural.
Not bad. Lillian?
15.
Okay. Everybody but Altair, something feels weird. The room has a kind of an energy to it, almost like the air is vibrating. Ollie, you may have experienced this in your training as a cleric, because more likely than not, you visited a battlefield at least once. And it's kind of that uneasy tension that people in like a war zone generally tend to have, where they're at any moment something crazy could happen, and so they're always kind of on edge. Lillian, you've experienced this many times before with your fascination with death. it's a very natural thing to happen in a dangerous area, and it's not just war zones. It can be bad parts of town. You know, whatever. It's just that overall tension that, you know, at any moment something really bad could happen. Altair, you're completely oblivious.
Okay.
As you guys are kind of contemplating this kind of weird feeling, because Anna, you know specifically, it didn't feel like this before when you were in here. Something has changed. While you guys are all contemplating this, the barmaid comes over and slams down some relatively large hunks of bread.
I take a silver out of my pouch and flick it over to her.
Catches it in midair, sequesters it in her bra, and walks away.
Thank you. Is it just me, or is anyone else's spider sense tingling?
Oh, I don't know what you're talking about.
You have a spider sense?
What do you mean? Yeah. I'm already like picking up the bread, eating it.
You notice that the bread is stale. Not like massively disgusting, but it's been sitting out for a couple of hours, so it obviously tasted better when it was fresher. Lillian, the meat that you've got is cold cuts, but it's obvious to you this is the meat that a couple hours ago was hot and was freshly cooked, and it's just kind of been sitting out and nobody else ate it yet. So it's not inedible or anything like that. It's just not the most appetizing thing in the world. Everything about this meal is just kind of meh. Yep. If you'd been up at the right time, maybe. Well, I think this might be Anna's second time eating, because I think Colin.
That's why I'm just getting bread. Yes.
Yeah. Offered you food too.
Yes.
Second breakfast.
Yeah. Second breakfast. So as you guys are sitting there, I'm going to have, who got the high? I think it was Ollie got the highest, right? You got the 20?
Yeah.
Go ahead and make me a perception check.
Perception. 16.
All right. So as you're sitting there, you know, trying to kind of figure out what it is, where this tension is coming from, you start to notice that a lot of the tension is coming from, it looks like, three or four different groups that are situated in different parts of the tavern itself. They seem fidgety. They're talking in hushed voices. They're kind of hunched over and talking to each other. they take up entire tables. Like, there isn't a single group of them that does not have, like, their entire table claimed. And they keep glancing at you guys. As you're noticing this, Altair, I'd like you to make a dexterity saving throw for me.
Ooh, okay, so dex save, that is a 26.
26. So, as you're sitting there eating your bread, you feel large amount of force come from behind you, like someone has just, like, pushed you or run into you or something like that. And it's actually a strong enough amount of force that it starts to take you out of your chair and kind of tip you over, and you kind of grip on to the table and kind of reshift your center of balance, and you stay upright. And as you do that, you see this humanoid form come crashing down next to you and hit the ground with a rather loud bang. You see the tray that they were holding goes flying. You see mead gets going spilled everywhere. It just barely misses getting all over you. This woman stands up. She has this kind of long, kind of unkempt, almost matted blonde hair, almost mane-like. And she's wearing this obviously used and very worn leather armor, and you can see on her waist is a short sword that has obviously seen battle. And she kind of gets up and goes, "You stupid, idiotic, poor excuse for a human being. You have just spilt my entire breakfast. You should apologize to me on your knees."
I look at her and I'm like, "You all right?" And I go into my pouch and I hand her 3 gold.
"Really? Really? What? Do I look like a whore to you? Do I look like I want your money? Do I look like I need your money, you sorry excuse for a half-breed? You disgust me."
At this point, I will stand up and say, "I'm very sorry. We would love if you would join us, but I will have to ask you to apologize."
Around to you, interrupting you completely, and go, "Did I ask to speak with you? Did I ask you to take your stupid, dirty, disgusting mouth and start talking to me, you nature-loving tree whore?"
"Excuse me?"
And she spins and goes back to Altair. You have besmirched my honor. I demand tribute. I demand payment in blood." And she starts to reach for her sword. "Defend yourself, you lousy excuse for a beast."
"I wouldn't recommend doing that."
"Lady, please. We're in public."
"I know you. You're that murderer. You killed that man in cold blood. You are supposed to be sentenced to death. Perhaps those in Daggerford would like to hear about this, you horrible buffoon."
"Anybody know what she's talking about?"
"No, I think she's crazy."
At that point, I want to put myself in between and just be like, "Look, friend.
I'm not your friend. I'm not your colleague. I am not your buddy. I am none. This man has blemished my honor and deserves to pay for it with his life. You are disgusting, you are horrible, and you do not deserve to defile the air that the rest of us are breathing." And now she draws her short sword.
Defend
yourself!
I wanted to kind of keep an eye out on the table I'm assuming that she's behind us, so I want to keep the table that would be in front of us, that we've been looking at us as well.
Sure. Go ahead and roll me a perception check with disadvantage, since the kind of spectacle of what she's doing is making it kind of difficult to not focus on her.
13.
Kind of glancing around, the tables where kind of that bad vibe was coming from, all of them are very interested in this. Now, the rest of the tavern is watching this as well, because this woman is making a scene. But it's obvious to you that the three tables that you kind of got the bad feeling from, they are very interested in it. Go ahead and roll me a history check while you're at it.
History. 17.
These are cultist tables. You recognize people at each one of the tables.
So
sorry, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, I just kind of try to keep myself in between them and say, look, this man has vowed not to shed blood. He is redevoting his life to peace. But if you must take blood, take mine.
And she says, gladly, and she thrusts her short sword into you.
Oh.
I don't have my dice out, so give me a second.
Can I polymorph real quick?
You don't have time. This happens. This is not something that a rational human being would do. This was not anywhere in your mind that she was going to take that as an offer to skewer you. So you're kind of completely unprepared for her to just out of nowhere stab you. Damn. I swear this is not as hard as I'm making it. Is it really bad that I have to sit here and go A, B, C, D, E, F to remember where these things are? Alright. So as she thrusts with the short sword, you see her other hand reach at her other hip where a long sword is, and she brings that to bear as well, making all three attacks against you, Enna. Does a 12 hit you?
A 12 does not.
Okay. That's a short sword. How about a 13?
13 does not.
Just keep rolling one number higher. That's a little bit better. 24?
That does, in fact, hit.
Okay. You take 7 slashing damages. The first thrust with the short sword, it surprises you, but you kind of jump out of the way and it goes right past you. Then you see this long sword coming at you and you kind of duck below it, but faster than you think should be possible, she kind of switches it around, brings the long sword, and it slices right along your ribs and hurts. You can see the rest of the tavern is now watching very closely as this woman kind of crouches down into a low fighting stance, ready for rebuttal. And I would like Enna to roll for initiative for me.
Yes, don't fight me.
22. And I say to the group, this is between me and her. And I say it loudly, this is between me and her. No one interfere.
You said 22, right?
I said 22.
All right, so you say that, and as you say that, you can see, Ollie, since you're kind of watching a little bit of everything, you see the other cultists kind of put their hands on their weapons and get to more advantageous positions to where if they need to get up and fight, they can. But they haven't jumped into combat yet. Feel of steel across your skin has awakened your reflexes rather quickly. You are first. What would you like to do?
Yeah, I'm just going to go for it. I'm going to cast Flame Blade.
Okay. So you guys watch as Enna, after saying this fight is between her and I, she reaches her hand out and this burst of flame shoots out from it. And as she kind of grasps onto it, it slowly forms into a scimitar.
And I'm going to strike at her with it.
All right. Make your attack.
14?
As you sit there and you bring the flaming scimitar down, incredibly quickly, faster than you think should be possible, she brings her longsword up and not just deflects the blow, but redirects it to the point where it just barely misses Altair and kind of forces him to jump back away from the table. And you get the idea that this particular fighter is well-versed in not just combat, but dueling in general.
Okay.
She reacts with lightning speed, attacking twice with her longsword, once with her short sword. 18.
That hits.
Okay. I used the wrong modifier. The last one would have been 16, not 18.
16 would just barely hit.
Okay.
That's my armor.
And that one would hit. So you take a grand total of... Oh, math is hard. 7 slashing damage and 6 piercing damage as the first blow from the longsword comes, again, blinding speed, slashes you right across your shoulder. The second blow from it comes, and you interject your flaming scimitar to deflect it. But as you do that, you open yourself up, and she brings that short sword in and digs right underneath your armor and pierces you.
Okay.
The rest of you guys are noticing that people are starting to come in from the courtyard, and Ollie, you specifically can see the half-orc leader everything standing there, kind of watching this whole ordeal take place. Enna, you are up.
As a bonus action, I'm going to cast Healing Word at 3rd level.
Okay.
So I heal 9.
So you guys watch as Enna is standing there with her flaming blade in one hand. She speaks some arcane words, and you see a few of her wounds begin to heal. The woman fighting her, she has no honor. She uses magic to help her win because she knows she cannot best me with a blade.
I go at her again with the flaming sword.
Go for it.
21.
I have to do math. So, yeah, you hit. Roll damage.
Oh, joy.
She has cool things that she can do that require me to make do math.
Oh, 16 damage.
You said 16, right?
Yes.
All right, so this time as you bring the blade around, she immediately brings her short sword up to parry it, and you anticipate this. You twist the blade at the last second and redirect it, and it goes straight across her arm, leaving this large burn mark and slight cauterized cuts, and she kind of cries out in pain. Anything else you want to do with your turn?
No.
Okay, so she immediately comes back with a flurry of blows. Boy, that's bad. That one won't. That one won't. I have rolled an 8, like, half the times I've done this. Her first swing with the longsword goes wide because of the pain in her arm. The second one finds purchase and cuts you right across your leg. Would have hamstringed you if she'd been in a more advantageous position. Then she brings her short sword in, and again, you deftly parry it, and you notice it singes a little bit of the very fine hair on her arm as the flaming scimitar gets just slightly too close to her. She's breathing rather heavily, but she's still ready to fight and take you down. Enna, you are up.
How much damage did she do to me?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Or did she?
7. 7 slashing damage.
Okay.
She'd do a lot more damage if the DM could roll higher than an 8.
Hey, I'm grateful. I'm going back in with the flaming sword.
Okay. You guys watch as Enna starts this spinning motion and brings the flaming scimitar around, trying to catch her with just blinding speed and force.
22.
Again, breaks through her defenses and cuts. Good roll damage.
14.
All right, she howls out in pain. Anything else you want to do with your turn?
No.
Okay, she howls out in pain and shoulder charges into you. I need you to make a strength athletics or dexterity acrobatics check.
Oh, definitely prefer. Acrobatics.
Okay. She hits you and knocks you to the ground hard. You feel the air escape your lungs, and as you're on the ground, you see her longsword coming down. Seventeen.
That hits.
And then her short sword is going to hit, but let's see if we crit. Nope. So you take 7 slashing and 6 piercing damage as both the long sword and the short sword find purchase in you as you're lying on the ground.
I'm going to cast Hold Person on her.
No!
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 Go ahead. You are not quite fast enough. What I'm going to have you do, Ollie, go ahead and roll me initiative.
I didn't want her to stop the attack. I just wanted to... Never mind.
That's fine. We're going to see exactly when it happens.
Okay. 12.
12? Okay, cool. So, as she starts to come back from... with her short sword dripping with Enna's blood. What's your spell save DC?
15.
And what's the...
Wisdom.
Wisdom? Okay. Oh, well, she's super wise. Yeah. As she comes up, Enna, you see a look of panic come across her face, and you watch as her muscles all immediately start to tighten, and she actually starts to shake a little bit.
I'll use Divine Augmentation to make a crack of thunder so that everybody focuses on me. This duel is done. She has won. Let no life be taken here. It's not. worth it.
I stand up and I
before you can do that, Altair makes this loud gesture, and you guys see about a dozen members that have been sitting at these tables stand up and start rushing in to try and subdue Ollie, and a few to come try and subdue Altair, as they've now seen that the sanctity of the duel has been broken.
I put my hands up and go, no, stop. Stop this. This is between the two of us.
You can do that on your turn. However, it is not your turn yet. This is happening so fast, because these guys were looking for a reason to fight. So this is happening so fast that you don't have enough time to react. So
you don't mess with a duel.
No, you don't.
Whoops.
Oh, I had this, you guys. I have this.
I thought they were looking more for a reason to blame you. And
That's fine.
How is that fine? I don't understand that.
Y'all are about to find out.
Crap.
So these guys all rush forward, wielding spears and longswords. Five of them go after Ollie, which may still be a pointless endeavor. I'm going to have to beef these guys up, because I don't think they're ever going to hit Ollie. No. 21? Does the 21 hit?
That one hits, yes.
Okay, so that's one hit. Does a 19 hit?
Yes.
Okay. 13, I'm going to assume, does not.
No.
All right, so you got two hits. You take a total of 10 piercing damage, as two of the ones with spears are able to make it through your defense and hit you. And I need two concentration checks from you. It's a DC 10, so it's
basically... It's just straight rolls, or do I add anything to
you
that?
You add your constitution modifier to it.
Constitution, sorry. Mm-hmm. 11 and 10.
11 and 10. So, hold person is still on. Three more, or four more actually, head towards Altair, and these have long swords. 11?
No.
22?
Hits.
21?
Hits.
6.
Miss.
So you take a total of 5 slashing damage as these four cultists come forward and just start slamming into you with their longswords. The remaining four, one of them comes and kind of pulls the woman that Enna has been battling with away to kind of, you know, keep her out of danger as much as possible. The other three all take pot shots at Enna on the floor. Uh, 16.
Hits.
Nine doesn't do it. So you take a total of 10 damage, 5 of it slashing, 5 of it piercing, as one spear and one sword.
So I'm unconscious now.
So you guys watch as Enna slips into unconsciousness and begins to bleed out, as this turns into a much larger brawl than it was previously. Altair, I need you to roll for initiative.
Seven.
Okay. Lillian, you have just seen Enna go unconscious, and a whole bunch of other shit. going down. Would you like to roll for initiative?
Yeah.
Go for it. What'd you get? Insight. Initiative, same difference.
13.
Okay. So, immediately after the guards go, Liliane, actually, you're able to react. What would you like to do? There are four people attacking Ollie, four people attacking Altier, three attacking Enna, and one that's just trying to wake up their friend from paralysis.
I draw my sword and I one of the ones.
Don't kill them.
Yeah, don't kill.
It's entirely up to you.
Yeah.
Oh. You guys are outnumbered 13-4.
Yeah.
So 13-3.
Well, yeah. This is basically 3-1 right now. Technically 4-1 if Enna doesn't get up.
Do what you want.
Okay. So you guys watch as Liliane draws her sword and leaps over the table to come basically over Enna's unconscious body, wielding her sword. What'd you roll?
15.
Definitely a hit. What do you do for damage?
9.
All right, so as you come forward with your longsword, you cut deep on one of these guys. You get him right underneath his breastplate, and you can see a large pool of blood starting to form at his feet as he's wavering a little bit, trying to hold on to his spear as much as he can. Anything else you want to do? Okay.
Roll me
an intimidation check. You can see a few of them kind of look at each other and then kind of brace together. It doesn't seem to have the effect that you wanted, but they did notice you. So, up next is going to be Ollie, actually.
Very cool. Oh,
so you got a bunch of friends around you. You don't think you're invited to their birthday parties anymore. It really sucks. They were going to have a magician.
Heal the dream.
Okay, I want to try something. Are we all essentially within like a 20-foot
easily
circle
you
area?
You guys are all within 5 feet of each other right now.
Even the okay, cool. So yeah, I'm going to drop.
All the guys, like most, are about 10 feet away from you right now. Like you guys are claustrophobic. You're so close.
I'm going to drop the whole person.
Okay.
And I'm going to cast Calm Emotions.
Okay.
That's a charisma saving throw.
Are you really going to make me make this many charisma saves? Someone just got disadvantaged for the rest of the campaign. I'm going to make charisma saving throws for each group of guards.
Yeah.
And then for the leader. So the group around you, what's the DC again?
That's a charisma saving throw. 15 was my spell save.
Okay, that one fails. That one fails. I don't know why I'm rolling this. They have no charisma. And then She's got shit too. Yeah, she's her charisma involves swords. Yeah, she fails. So you watch as this wave of calm emanates from you. And due to your previous insight checks, you recognize something interesting. Your connection with the arcane and your connection with your deity and casting these spells, you know that all but one group of four, everyone but the group around Enna was affected by this spell. You can feel their emotions kind of calming, and you can see that it's not changing their resolve, almost to the point that this wasn't like a hot-blooded decision. This was anticipated and tactical. So by calming their emotions, you have given them focus.
Oh, that's not what I want to do.
However, take inspiration, because that was a really, really cool idea.
Okay. What level, or what size,
D10? Inspiration is not bardic inspiration. It means, you can give yourself advantage on one attack roll, ability check, saving throw. Basically, okay. 1d20 roll, you can give yourself advantage.
Cool.
Or okay. Anybody else. But once you use up the inspiration, it's gone. They really should have named it something different than because they have bardic inspiration in the game, but that's what they called it.
Okay.
Anything else you want to do with your turn? I believe you still have a bonus action and a move left.
I believe... No, Healing Word is not a bonus action, is it?
It is, but you already cast a leveled spell, so you wouldn't be able to cast Healing Word.
Then I won't do anything.
All right.
But, yeah.
So that brings us to Altair. You are up.
Non-lethal damage. I don't even bother drawing a weapon. I'm just going
to You are it. Right next to Anna.
Oh, so, I am.
Yeah. If you wanted to try and, you know, feed her healing potion or punch her to consciousness...
I spend a key point and I'm going to punch Anna into consciousness.
She is prone, so you have advantage on all of these.
And she's incapacitated, so when I hit, I auto-crit.
You are correct. I didn't think about that when I made that ability, but let's go with it, because I like it.
Let's see here. That's a 15, and I believe that's your AC.
Anna.
My AC is 16.
Okay.
Oh. So you barely missed the first one.
Yeah, that one. That'll
really,
hit.
I really love this idea.
So you heal four.
Nine.
Okay.
That was then, crit damage?
Yes. Okay. And then the second one.
Now, she is no longer incapacitated, so this won't be an auto crit.
Yeah. I believe that's a 16.
16 hits?
You heal for 9 again.
Nice. So you get 18 hit points. You immediately open your eyes and realize that what once before was a relatively simple duel has devolved into something crazy.
And then I whisper to Anna, non-lethal bear.
Unfortunately, it is the leader's turn, and she, seeing Anna open her eyes again, immediately rushes in because she's no longer paralyzed to attack Anna. 15 misses. That's one hit. You take 7 slashing damage as she comes forward, and She tries to attack once, and you're able to roll away. She drags the longsword across the ground and slashes your shoulder, and then brings the short sword down, and you watch it go right for your face and move right to the side as it hits the wood right next to your ear and pulls up. Anna, you're up.
You heard me say non-lethal bear.
That
is up to Anna to decide if she heard that or not.
That's fair.
So, I'm assuming when I fell back and went unconscious, my flame blade dissipated.
It did, because it's concentration.
Alright, so I'm...
Is it concentration?
Look
it up for me real quick. Because theoretically, if it was, you should have been making concentration checks, and I forgot.
It is concentration.
So it would have disappeared when you went unconscious.
What am I thinking of? If you let go of the blade, it disappears, and you can invoke the blade as a bonus action.
Yeah,
but you have to... that's fine. I'm fine with the blade going away because now I'm going to try for non-lethal.
Okay.
Because I'm just gonna stand up, use my movement to stand up, just look around at everybody like, I told you guys not to interfere. I'm going to pull my stick out of the bag of holding and shillelagh the leader.
Okay. So you guys watch as Enna sits there and pulls out this stick and then concentrates on it, and the stick becomes massive. And it has this kind of gnarled end that looks deadly. Go ahead and make your attack roll.
One!
Oh, no.
And as you bring the shillelagh down, you slam it, and you feel it. You feel it make purchase. And at this point, you're not even watching. You're just like, and you feel it make purchase, and you look, and you just destroyed a corner of the table.
Nice.
Anything else you want to do with your turn?
No.
All right, Liliane, you are up. No, you have noticed that a few of them have started to focus on you instead of other targets. They seem to consider you as dangerous. So, you've now become an important target to take down. I'm sorry, I didn't catch that. What'd you say? Okay. There's two others that were attacking Anna. Yeah. So the one that you already hit, you don't want to hit this time.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Go for it.
Seven.
Definitely a hit. Go and roll damage. So as you swing your sword, you move so deftly that you slice him across his stomach, and you watch his eyes grow real wide, and then he drops to the floor dead.
One more to Kalev more.
Yeah.
Anything else you want to do with your turn? Do you have a second attack?
I can't remember. She does.
Yeah,
she
does.
Okay. Well, the one you just attacked is dead, so you can't. Well, you could attack him again. It won't do it. It's not going to get him to Kelimvor any quicker. Go for it.
You
I have to look. These guys are not the leader They're not, you know, massively heavily armored and like cool. That one does miss. Ricochets off the shield. Oh no, he's not wearing a shield. Oh, it still misses. Anything else you want to do with your turn?
No.
Okay. That brings us to the guards. So the two that are left alive that were attacking Enna have now shifted their focus to you. The one that pulled the leader away when she was paralyzed is coming after you. And one person each from Altair's group and Ollie's group are coming after you as well. So you have a total of five people swinging at you. 20. Does a 17 hit?
Me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's two hits. That's a 5. That's a 9. And then another 20. So a grand total of 3 hits. You take a total of 10 slashing damage and 5 piercing damage as 3 of the 5 guys are able to find purchase and get around your defense. Three friends for Altair. Actually, let's say 2 friends for Altair.
Okay.
9.
Yes.
18.
That hits.
5 piercing damage.
Hit.
Anna, one of the people that was attacking Altair is going to turn and try and take a swing at you.
Okay.
19.
That hits.
5 piercing damage as a spear pierces your side. And then Ollie, you still have 3 friends.
Okay.
20.
Yep.
9. And 19.
2.
10 slashing damage as 2 long swords are able to get past your armor. That brings us to Ollie, it's your turn.
Well, because last time worked so well.
It was really, really creative. And in a different situation would have worked exactly the way you wanted it to.
Yeah. I will cast Beacon of Hope.
Very, very cool.
So that's 3rd level, that's right. And that's all I can really cast, so that's my turn.
Okay, if you have any healing potions or anything, you guys are so close.
Oh, that's right.
But that takes an action. You could bonus action for yourself to take a healing potion. Would still get maximum healing.
Okay. I do have one of those, so I'll do one of those.
Okay. So you take maximum healing.
Just standards.
Bonus.
So that's
how much? It's 2d4 plus 2, so it's 10 hit points.
10, okay, cool.
All right. That brings us to Altair.
Scary.
Anna's looking a little bit rougher than she was before.
Yeah, I draw my short sword, and I just slap the shit out of one of them that are attacking me.
Okay.
The non-lethal is what I'm going for.
Okay.
11 to hit.
Misses.
I'm going to flurry of blows him non-lethal as well.
Okay.
That is a 13 to hit.
Miss.
Really?
They're wearing chain shirts, so chainmail.
Okay. I'm going to switch dice. That is a 19 to hit.
That definitely hits. Go ahead and roll damage.
He takes 8.
So as you sit there, you swing, you thrust this short sword at them, attempting to hit a part of the body that will disable them without killing them. You're unable to make it through the chainmail whatsoever. You come around with an elbow and strike hard metal, but then you come up with a knee and smack him right in the bridge of the nose. You see blood pouring down his face. He's blinking a little bit, looking slightly disoriented from the very quick movement that you made. Anything else you want to do with your turn?
Nope.
The leader, seeing Anna laboring to breathe, decides to press her attack. And actually, she's going to do this kind of backwards, but 22.
That hits.
Does 5 damage put you unconscious?
You'll be at
it
1.
It does not.
Okay. Yes. She brings the long sword down, slashing you, and does another shoulder charge. Acrobatics or athletics, whichever you prefer.
I'm going to attempt to dodge out of the way. 15?
She sits there, and as she charges into you with her shoulder, you bring the shillelagh up and just kind of smack it in a way that deadens a lot of the impact, and she's not able to push you over. She comes around with the short sword. With a 20.
That hits.
And that is 6 piercing damage.
And I'm unconscious again.
You guys watch Enna collapse to the ground again. Enna, it's your turn. Give me a death save, please.
It was going to be so cool, guys.
Sorry I screwed you up.
19 or 16. Either way.
Perfectly fine. That brings us down to Lillian. You have 5 people that have become really good friends with you.
Hey, just so you know, you have advantage on death saving throws, just so you know.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. So roll again, see if you can get a 20 on it.
Let's go. 19.
Mm. Close, but no cigar. All right, sorry, Lillian.
So,
okay. One of the guys attacking you is the one you hit before and looks pretty bad. Do you want to hit him, or do you want to hit one of the guys that hasn't been hit yet?
I'll hit him.
Go for it. Make your attack roll. Deflects it.
I'll try again.
Okay.
21.
Definitely hit. Go ahead and roll damage.
I'm at 14.
So you guys watch as Lillian takes one swing and he bats it away with his spear. So Lillian spins around, brings her longsword across, and decapitates him.
Oh!
The other 4 guys that are attacking are kind of look at each other and start realizing this may not be the greatest idea in the world. But they're emboldened by numbers, so. Anything else you want to do?
No.
All right. Lillian, you get 4 attacks. 15? Higher than that? No. All right. You take a grand total of 15 slashing damage as 3 attacks connect. How many people? Only 2 of them have died so far. both of those by Lillian. Altair, you've got 2 friends. That's a nat 20.
Oh, crap.
And super low. Don't worry, like, crits with this goes from a 5 to a 9. You take 9 piercing damage as a spear hits a vulnerable spot. Anna had one person still on it. That's going to go for Altier now since he's close. 15 Altier?
Nope.
Misses you. There are still 3 on... who's you? That's it. Ollie. 18?
That is my armor class.
Okay, so that's 1 hit. 2 hits. And a miss. Total of 10 piercing damage as 2 spears poke you through your armor. Right. And that ends them. Ollie, you are up.
Anna is still down, yeah?
Yes, she's currently unconscious.
How close am I to her?
Within 5 feet. I'm going to say that you guys are close enough that as long as you don't mind standing on a table, you can get to anyone within 5 feet.
Okay. I'm going to go up to her and cast a 3rd level Cure Wounds.
So, max healing. It should be, what, yeah, 3d8 plus your wisdom?
3d8.
Plus the spell level because he's a cleric of life.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so. That's a lot of math. 4 for my wisdom, 24 for the dice, 28. Yeah. The level is 3, so that's 31.
Anna, you and feel really good.
33 total.
So.
Oh, wow.
As Ollie comes over and just kind of like very gently kind of does. Hey, you're not done yet. That was your bonus action.
Hey, that cricket in my neck is gone. Wound,
sorry.
Yeah.
Anything else you want to do with your turn?
I'll take my last healing potion.
I forgot to have you make 2 concentration checks. Sorry.
For what?
You got hit twice. Beacon of Hope is concentration, isn't it?
Is that? I don't think it is. Is it?
Go ahead and look it up for me real quick. Cause I don't
it have is. HP. It is.
Right next to me. It would require me to reach, and that's far too much work for me.
Yep, he's right, it is.
All right, okay. So 2 concentration checks.
Let's see. The lowest one was 11.
You're fine. Again, it's okay. DC 10, so as long as you're a 10 or higher, you're fine. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, so go ahead and take your 10 hit points.
Okay.
Anything else you want to do with your turn?
That's it.
All right. That brings us to Altier. You got friends.
None. I'm going to non-lethal short sword on one I haven't hit yet.
Okay.
That is an 18 to hit.
Definitely hits. Roll damage.
He takes 9 damage.
He looks rough, but he is upright as you smack him with the pommel of the short sword.
Flurry of blows on the one I just hit.
Okay.
That is 22 to hit.
Definitely hits. Roll damage.
He takes 7.
Okay. Was this non-lethal?
Yeah.
Okay. So as you sit there and you smack him with the hilt of your short sword, he kind of goes a little bit, and you bring an elbow around and conk into him, and he falls over unconscious.
And then I'm going to kick at the one that I hit last round.
Go for it.
Non-lethal. That's a nat 1, but I'm a halfling, so I'm lucky. And that's 24.
Definitely a hit for damage. I don't think 7. You can roll low enough. Yeah. You come around with a back spin kick, and you feel a very satisfying crunch as you think you just crushed his cheekbone as he falls over unconscious.
I said it was non-lethal, so he's not dead. He's just hurt.
Yes, but his face will forever remember your foot. Because cosmetic surgery ain't been invented yet. Anything else you want to do with your turn?
Nope, that's my turn. One guy just saw his two friends go down.
Seeing as... Altier, even or odd?
Even.
Or actually, no. She's smart enough that she realizes that Ollie is the one that's being a pain in the ass. So the leader refocuses and starts swinging at Ollie.
I...
11 is worthless. 9 is worthless. Wow. Ignore her. She comes over with a long sword. You protect it with your shield. She comes back around and it bounces off your armor. She plunges her short sword into a joint in the armor, and you twist so it just deflects off. That brings us back to Enna. You are prone.
Okay, so I... if I wanted to stand up, how much of that movement would it take?
It's half your movement, so... Whatever half your movement is. I think it's 15 feet.
So, okay, so what I would like to do is roll over. So I'm on my stomach.
Okay.
Look up at her and say, I'm not done with you yet, bitch. Polymorph into a white dire wolf and just go for her throat.
As part of polymorph, do you get an attack?
Because I am, I think, Circle of the Moon, I get combat wild shape, so it's a bonus action.
Oh, so this isn't polymorph, this is beast shape.
Oh, yeah. Sorry, beast shape. Okay.
I thought you were casting the spell polymorph, which is a slightly different
no,
spell.
No. But...
No, cool, go for it.
So, yeah, I roll over, scream at her, and then turn into a white dire wolf and just charge her.
Go for it.
So, and because she moved...
Does your white
dire wolf
have a name? Pardon? Does your white dire wolf have a name?
No.
Okay.
But since she moved against Ollie, she's within 15 or 5 feet, right?
Yeah. She's still within 5 feet.
So pack sense, or sorry, pack tactics. Yep. I get advantage.
Yeah, first,
which is good
because it just requires an ally, right?
Yeah,
yeah,
then, or yes. An ally within 5 feet.
Yep.
So
I wasn't sure if it needed someone else with pack tactics or not, but no, nope. Just an ally.
An ally that is not incapacitated.
He's fine. I think he probably has the highest hit points out of everybody.
So, 21 to hit.
That hits.
Okay. So I roll...
Do you have multi-attack or no?
I do not.
Oh, okay. Then, yeah, go for it.
So,
I was just going to say, if you have more than one attack, just roll them all, because she hasn't even broken a sweat yet.
So, 13 to hit. Or, sorry, no, 13 damage. I apologize.
Okay. Now she looks rough.
She has to make a... if the target is a creature, it must make or must succeed on a DC 13 strength saving throw or be knocked prone.
What's the DC again?
13 on a strength.
Okay. She is prone. You guys watch as Enna leaps up and takes this large bite out of like her clavicle area. As Enna does this, it takes her all the way to the ground, and as Enna walks away, you can see her pure white fur is now stained red around the mouth with blood dripping from it. Anything else you want to do?
Just howl.
Very cool. Liliane.
Hi. I still have...
You have 4.
Four.
Yeah, you killed one. There's still 4. Actually, I think there's only 3 left on you. No. Anyone that's been hit is dead now or unconscious. Other than the leader.
Alright, so I can't. I'm gonna stop whoever I'm
Go for it. Do you want to activate your Crimson Rite or no?
No.
Okay.
16.
16 is definitely a hit. Go and roll damage.
10 damage.
So you come across, slash deep, right across the chest. You can see the guy that you just hit is breathing really, really heavily. He's bleeding profusely, but he's still barely standing.
I get try to finish him off.
Go for it.
20.
Definitely a hit. Roll damage.
So much for non-lethal.
He's gone. Yet again, you come around and shink, another head goes boom, 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 boom.
They've just seen Lillian like decapitate two of their friends.
They still technically have a numbers advantage over you guys. It's getting smaller, but
I would think so.
Anything else you want to do?
And a bonus action, and I think a bonus
action. Yep. Beacon of Hope is still active, so that's just 10 hit points. It's time for the guards. I've got 1, 2, 3, 4.
There's one on me left.
Okay, so we'll take the one on you. 15?
Miss.
Swing and a miss. It's one, so it's 1, 2, 3. Yeah, that makes sense. So 3 on Lillian. 19.
Yeah, there.
Another 19. And a 15.
There.
15 slashing damage as 3 hit you. And then Ollie, you have 3 as well.
Okay.
Oh, wait, no. I think there's still 1 on Anna and there's only 2 on Ollie. Anna, 14?
For sorry, 14?
White direwolf form AC.
Yeah.
14 is my wolf's AC.
Alright, 5 piercing damage. 2 attacks on Ollie. That's a 20.
Mm-hmm.
And higher than that. So you take 10 piercing damage as 2 spears hit you.
Okay.
And then 2 saving throws, I assume.
Yep, 2 con saves. Okay. Or 2 concentration checks, I'm sorry.
Gotcha. Well, lowest is a 7, so I guess I'll at least Beacon of Hope now.
Yeah, so Beacon of Hope unfortunately ends. However, it's your turn, so.
Okay. That also ruined that idea.
And the leader is prone next to you, by the way.
Alright. Where is, who's lower, Lillian or Altair on health points?
I'm at like 27.
I'm at 16.
So, Lillian, okay.
Thought you were going to say, I'm at 6. Damn!
So, I'm going to cast a second level. Wait, she's. I can touch her right now, can I?
Yeah, you can touch anyone.
Okay.
Well, I'm gonna cast second level. There's a whole thing about consent.
Okay. All right.
There's an HR video you gotta watch before you can heal.
Oh boy.
Then there's this
cast
test.
Second level cure wounds.
Go for it.
That's 14 on the dice. 18, 20.
All right. 20 hit points to Lillian. Anything else you want to do with your turn?
No.
Altair, you are
up. I'm going to take 2 non-lethal unarmed strikes on this guy.
Go for it.
Ooh, that's a miss.
Okay.
And that's a nat 20.
That misses too.
You take.
Roll non-lethal crit damage.
Oh, jeez. So I kind of kick off of the table and do one of those, like, jump off the wall kicks to the face. Because I'm a halfling, I need the distance, and I do 11 damage.
Hits the ground hard. Start snoring.
I have 3 unconscious people next to me, and I just look at the group to see how they're doing.
Yeah. Altair's just kind of brushing himself off at that point. Chris, you guys are bleeding. The leader, realizing that the heavily armored and shield Ollie is going to be a slightly waste of her time, she returns her efforts back to the dire wolf.
Leader's also prone.
She stands up.
Okay.
I'll guarantee that's a hit. 22.
Yes.
20. And higher than that. So that's 14 plus 6. It's a grand total of 20. 14 slashing, 6 piercing.
Okay.
You're still a wolf?
Whirls with unnatural speed. That ends her turn. Anna.
Okay. Okay, so I am going to attack her again.
Go for it.
I'm assuming she's still close to Ollie.
Yeah. She's close to everyone. You guys are all fighting on a table. This is very Three Musketeers, like Zorro-esque. 90s, like, swashbuckling movie.
I only rolled a 20 to attack.
Misses, unfortunately. No, that hits. Technically, just barely, but it hits.
That's all that matters. Eight plus 3, 11 damage.
All right, is this another save?
It's another save.
What's the save again?
13 strength.
All right, so you jump up and bites on the other side, drawing blood. Her armor is now stained and dripping with her own blood. You can taste and feel bits of her flesh dripping from your jaws as you come down. But this time she holds her footing. She's looking really, really rough, though.
I will lick my lips and taste the blood and use combat wild shape to expend a level 3 spell slot and regen 3d8 hit points.
Go for it. But you're missing that beacon of hope now.
One.
No.
So I heal 10 points.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, that would have been awesome.
Lilian. Just keep, like, there's still heads that are attached to bodies, you know? I'm starting to think that Ronco's going to start sponsoring you.
That's a bad one.
So you kind of fumble with your sword, plunge it directly into their chainmail, which does nothing.
Yeah. And 14.
14 does hit.
Right. And I do 7 damage.
All right, so you come around. That was the wrong button. That button. So after missing with that, you come around, slash up, go along the side, and cut deep into their ribs. You can see the chainmail starting to get stained red with blood. Anything else you want to do?
No.
Cool. It's guard time.
I have nobody on me anymore.
one person still on Enna. That's a nat 20. So that is 9 piercing damage as a spear pokes you from behind.
Kind of leap in the air a little bit.
Start saying things like, you know, beast shape is not consent. And two people take swings at Lillian, or three people take swings at Lillian. 17?
Yeah.
14?
Yeah.
And a nat 20. So that's 19 total piercing damage, 3 spears, pokey pokey poke.
Lillian's at 17.
Yeah. 2 hits for Ollie. Ignore that. second one hits, though. 5 piercing damage.
Okay.
That brings us to Ollie. You've got 2 friends and a really bloody leader right next to you.
How is Lillian just got hit, but how are you all here? You fine?
Still 27.
Still 27. That's what I figured. Okay.
Nobody's next to Altier, so.
Yeah, that's what I figured.
Altier's getting the lawn chair out.
The body sipping on a Mai Tai. I'll just cast the first level cure wounds on Lillian again.
Okay.
7 on the dice. 11, 13 points.
13.
Yeah, 13.
All right. Anything else you want to do?
And I have no more potions, so I'll be fine. I'll just sit there. And
okay.
That's my turn.
Altier. Do you have a preference
jump up
as to which suntan lotion you use?
I jump up on one of the tables and kind of jog behind the one that Lillian just hurt, and I'm going to try and spare him of Kalevmore's wrath.
Okay. You can see Lillian sitting there 20. Going, what the head? What was the attack?
Nat 20.
It hits. Roll damage.
7.
So you jump up on the table and do a flying knee into this guy's head. His head gets knocked back. Lillian kind of gives you this look of like, the fuck? And you actually, your momentum carries you down on top of this guy as he hits the ground. Anything else you want to do with your turn?
Bonus action, I'm going to kick the back of the knee of one of the other ones. Okay. Non-lethal, of course. 22 to hit.
Definitely hits, roll damage.
9.
So you sit there, and as you kick the back of the knee, he pitches forward and slams his head into the table. And as he gets up, his nose is permanently moved to the side and blood is rushing down.
They will remember. They will remember me.
The ones that still have heads. The leader, almost going into a frenzy now. Takes a swing at Enna again. 15.
That hits.
14?
That hits.
And higher.
That does not hit.
So a total of 20 slashing and piercing damage.
Oh!
Are you no more a wolf?
So, I... partway through that, I shift back out, taking 7 points of damage in my natural form.
Okay. Actually, take away 6 of that damage, because she's going to try and shoulder charge you again. Oh, no, that would make sense to do. Never mind. No, keep the 6 points.
Okay.
That's the end of her turn. It's your turn, Anna.
Want to try that shoulder again?
Like, she's looking really rough.
I will recast Flame Blade.
Okay.
Spend another spell slot, and I will strike at her. Stab at her. 17?
As the blade comes close, you watch with lightning speed as she brings her short sword up and deflects it.
Oh, these people and their feet, man.
Again, that's all I can do.
To be very, very well versed in combat. That ends that. Lillianne. There's still some heads left.
So I go to the path that got a wagon coffee and noted that he thinks he was correct. And Captain Diamond out here is a danger.
She kind of seen Lillianne bring her sword up, go, damn it, and just shift a little bit.
Oh, he's done.
And shoom, blum, blum, blum. Another head hits the floor. You keep doing these massive amounts of damage when guys have like 1 hit point, 2 hit points. There's 1 more on you. There's 2 on Ollie, and then 1 on Anna. Go for it. Just barely under as you swing. He brings his long sword up and is able to block it. Anything else you want to do with your turn?
No.
So he swings at you. 19.
Yeah.
5 slashing damage. 1 pokes at Anna. 22.
That hits.
5 piercing damage. 2 take swings at Ollie. 20 and 6. So that's 5 slashing damage, Ollie.
Okay.
And that's the end. That brings us to Ollie.
Anna, how are you on hit points right now?
About half. 21.
Okay. I'm not looking good, so I'm going to cast a first level Cure Wounds on myself. 12 more. Okay.
Anything else you want to do?
Is the leader over on... The leader's right next to me, isn't she?
Yeah, she took a swing at you.
That's right.
Previously, and then turned around to fight the dire wolf.
Can I hit with a shield? I can't. I've never tried that. Can
There's
I?
A feat that lets you do that, but without
shield master.
Okay. Okay. Never mind. That's it. It's your turn.
Okay. Altair.
Last guy on Liliana. Take another unarmed strike at.
Okay.
That's a 22 to hit.
Definitely hits.
You take 7.
So you come up, punch him right in the chest. You feel a cracking sensation, and he coughs up a fair amount of blood.
And then I'm going to try and knock him out again. So non-lethal. That is a 17 to hit.
Definitely a hit. Roll damage.
6.
So, getting tired of this, after you crack his ribs and he coughs up some blood, you just and bring your foot up right between his legs. You watch his eyes go real big, and then he collapses.
That's number 5.
Anything else you want to do with your turn?
No, I'm done.
You start noticing he's saying words you've never heard before. Despite the fact that you're relatively certain that you speak the same language, these are brand new words you have never heard before. He slowly slips into unconsciousness. The leader, she's tasting blood. She's going to go after Anna again. 11. Even lower. Oh, Lord. 13.
Sorry, 15?
13.
Oh, no.
So that's Anna not. Just sits there and just watches the attacks go right past. Not even worrying about it. Brings us back up to Anna.
She's the arch is standing up. Still.
You can see she's got blood there. You can see her scale mail is soaked with blood. It's dripping from certain places. She looks really rough.
Question. When I beast-shaped back, the blood that was on the wolf's lips is still on my lips, right?
Sure.
Okay.
If you want it that way, sure.
I just
kinda got like a Princess Mononoke thing going on, but whatever.
I just like lick the blood. And just put an evil grin on my face and go right for her.
Bloodborne diseases. I'm sorry. You better have your cleric check you out after this. I'm just saying.
Oh, I got her. Okay. So I'm going in with my flame blade. Go for it. 24.
Definitely a hit.
Oh. 12 damage.
How do you want to do this?
I just want to stab her in the heart. And as the blade goes in, I just want to say, so is this payment enough? And then just twist it and pull back.
So you guys watch. As Anna, as this guard comes over, takes a swing at Anna, or as the leader comes over and takes a swing at Anna, the first one Anna just ducks under. She comes back, and Anna brings up her flaming scimitar and deflects it. And the third one, kind of, you see her thrusting towards you with the short sword, but you're just a little bit faster. You get inside and actually burn her wrist with the scimitar as you kind of parry and thrust in the same motion. She drops the short sword as she watches this blade of pure flame impale upon her, and she kind of grabs onto your hand as the blood starts to trickle out, and she looks at you, and you can see a single tear coming down as you go, "Is that payment enough?" And she goes, and she kind of puts her hand on your face with her blood smearing down as you twist it, and she jerks and falls over dead. As that happens, you hear from the back of the room, "All right, that's enough." And you see Bogluck come in, and he lifts you off and with surprising ease throws you back, and then comes down with his gauntlet covered fist and slams into the two cultists that are still attempting to attack Ollie and failing miserably, and knocks them back and kind of picks Ollie up by top of your armor and kind of just stares at you. That is enough.
I've pulled up into one of the benches already.
You all are going to clean this place up so that it's spotless. And out of almost nowhere, you see mops and buckets get pushed forward, almost as if he was kind of expecting this.
Can I just insight check that?
Yeah.
Sure.
Right from his face, can I do that too?
Sure. Ollie, I'll give you advantage, seeing as you can smell his breath.
Oh, okay, cool.
That's an 11.
Okay. He's massively hard to read, you, Altier.
It's a natural 20.
You get the idea that he doesn't seem like he was in on this idea to ambush you or anything. But as soon as he saw what was happening, he knew that there was going to be something to clean up. And so, kind of a combination of insight check and kind of remembering back through the battle. Shortly after kind of the free-for-all brawl started, he motioned off to one of his guys to go get mops and buckets.
Oh, okay.
I'm just doing stretches as I walk over to the mops and bucket.
He continues with, "If I see any of your sorry faces making trouble in here again, you will regret it." And Ollie, with your nat 20, you know that that's more of a, not really a threat against your life as much as an attempt at keeping control of what could turn into a very volatile situation. You get the idea that he probably enjoyed watching a bunch of people slug it out. As much as yes, people died, you had an insanely talented combatant going up against a fairly equally talented group of adventurers. This was fun to watch. Everyone cool. That's not you or the cultists that were directly involved in the fight has been cleared out. It is all just right. You and I think it's the three remaining cultists that still have their heads.
Well, three alive, five knocked out.
Yeah, the ones that are unconscious have been taken away.
All right.
By the other cultists that weren't involved in the actual brawl.
As the cultists take it further away, I am right my brain clean so they can see it.
And you notice that the three cultists that are still alive are cleaning up blood spills that are as far away from you as possible. And they seem for whatever reason, you think they might have maybe like a rash or something, because they keep rubbing their necks.
One person when he wakes up, his jaw is just permanently to the side. One person can never have kids again. They'll all remember me.
The guy that you kicked, you really don't think children were in his future. He didn't seem like the family type. So you don't feel as bad as, you know, the idea of stopping him from procreating.
Well, as I'm like mopping with a mop, I'm like, that was fun.
The mess is bad. And due to the fact that they have to serve a midday meal, I'd like everyone to make constitution saving throws for me.
Sure.
Well,
15.
Okay.
11.
All right.
7.
10.
All right, so everyone but Altair, you guys have one level of exhaustion from working hard, probably harder than you have worked in a very, very long time. Because you basically had roughly about 2.5 hours to get everything clean, to get the tables back in place. Altair, or no, Enna, they made you attempt to repair the table that you broke. Which, do you have the mending cantrip?
I do not.
Oh, okay. So yeah, that was rough. So yeah, Enna, Ollie, and Lillian, you guys all have exhaustion level 1. Altair, you are winded, but okay. And the kitchen staff, the workers that work at unloading the carts and everything, as they come in for their meal, and everyone else that's still there comes in for the meal, they kick you out. Tell you that you can eat after everybody else. And the two cultists that were involved in the, or the three cultists that are still alive, that are involved in the brawl, they're kicked out as well. You guys have to wait to eat lunch.
As we're all kicked out together, I just kind of nod at the three cultists, crack my fingers, okay. And walk to my room.
During this,
so fast out of there, like, you guys don't even get a chance. Like, as soon as you kind of wink at them, they're gone.
Okay. So during this whole like cleaning period,
I don't see an
I'm just not even looking at Altair. Mm-hmm. And then once we're done, I'm just gonna go straight back into the room,
guys.
Okay. So Enna and Altair have head back to the room. Ollie, Lillian.
Thank you. I'll go back.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll head back.
All right. So you guys are all back in the room. I'm assuming Enna looks kind of standoffish.
Rough.
At the moment.
Well, no. Once we get back in the room, I just go up to Altair and I just slap him.
What I do?
What were you thinking?
He casted a spell. And
I was doing this to protect you.
I didn't do anything until after I felt things were going to kick off.
I told all of you to stay out of this. What would have happened if we weren't lucky and if it had just been between me and her, and if I had died, that would have been one of us. The rest of you could have taken back what we learned and saved everyone. Instead, you put everyone in jeopardy.
Enna, if you're going to be mad at anyone, it's me. I cast a spell.
You?
Yes.
I thought it was
some sort of excuse for them to all come after us. I wanted to stop her.
It was the excuse. They were expecting all of you to jump in to try to save. They were expecting everyone to jump in and save whoever it was they tried to attack. And we played right into their hands. We have to be smarter about this. There may be sacrifices to be made in order to do this, in order to save the world. We can't do that again.
World.
Balrog decided to throw us up for murder charges again?
That's what my thought was. I was trying to prevent that, but I didn't realize that they would come after. I'm sorry.
We just need to be more careful.
I tried to mitigate what he did, but they were already jumping on us.
I don't think you're wrong, but on the other hand, we did send a set of methods to the two that this with the won't go down as easy as they are. Yeah.
They did lose a talented fighter there, and I don't think one can procreate, so...
They would have lost her anyway.
Yeah, and now they've all... several others as well.
Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm going to take a short rest.
I'll do the same, and exhausted myself in that fight.
Okay. So you guys take an hour, short rest, burn any hit dice that you want.
Let's see what I get. Hey, I rolled exactly my max hit points.
Always nice.
Then I get my key back.
Almost full.
So after waiting for an hour, you guys kind of bind your wounds do as best you can. Anna, Ollie, and Lillian, you guys still have your exhaustion now because it's going to take a long rest to get rid of that. But,
yep.
You get the idea that now that roughly an hour and a half-ish has passed, you can probably go and get a midday meal if you want it.
You guys want to head back there?
Yes.
I'm curious just what's going on now.
Yeah. I personally could use a drink.
So as you guys get back in there, you notice that the feeling of the room is a little bit more low-key. You don't feel that tension that you felt before. The room itself is almost empty. There are none of the cultists in here. All the workers are already back unloading wagons and things like that. And the few other people in here just kind of seem to be on, like, breaks or something like that. The barmaid comes over and goes, "Well, if it isn't my favorite customers, it's going to smell like death for a week and a half now. What you want?"
Ale.
Right, what about
bread and meat? Bread and meat and some ale as well.
We've got a little bit of wine left, some cheeses, bread. All out of meat.
Bread and cheese. Bread and cheese.
I'll take bread and cheese as well.
All of it, please.
All right.
Yeah.
So she goes back.
I will also use Druid. Because I think I can use Druid craft to create a natural scent.
Yep.
I cast Druid or use Druid craft to make the room smell like flowers.
Okay.
Daisies,
it's
specifically.
It's kind of like using air freshener in the idea that it sits on top of the scent. So it doesn't completely, like, get rid of it, but it does make it much more bearable. To be perfectly honest, because you guys cleaned it up, the smell of blood and everything is not incredibly strong, but it's definitely noticeable. And because wood is porous and stuff like that, like it's not going to be pleasant.
Right. It is an air freshener right now.
Yeah. So she comes over, and as she puts everything down, she just walks away.
Wait, I hand her 2 silver pieces just
and
for the mess.
She looks at you, gives you a slight little wink, and walks away without taking it.
Okay. I put it back. Can I insight check that wink?
Sure.
I'm just weird. That is, what's my insight? 20 total?
She... because of your history, you're not quite as familiar with this as... maybe like Valdis might be, But you get the idea that she was flirting with you. Something has happened that apparently you have caught her on.
Maybe it's because I didn't make a mess and I put my coins away.
Whatever it is. So yeah, you guys have, she brought probably close to like 3/4 full bottle of wine, bread and cheese, enough for the rest of you guys. It's a relatively large bottle of wine, so it's enough for everyone to have, you know, a glass and a half easily. She also brought Anna a stein of ale.
I'll pour myself a glass of wine and just start eating.
You're surprised that the bread is soft, almost like it was relatively recently baked. Not like the stale stuff you ate earlier. The rest of you guys, it's not the freshest stuff in the world, but it's not bad.
Oh my god.
I would have drank the first glass pretty quickly after realizing what the mistakes he made.
It's actually not bad wine. Ollie, with you being a cleric, you don't partake in alcohol a ton, but you have probably had relatively good stuff because clerics in general are thought of very highly. So in your training, you probably had you've probably tasted a wide range of some of the finer things in life just from being around nobles. And this is not bad. It ain't, you know, this is nothing that, you know, Valdis would have in his manor home. But it's definitely not the swill that you were expecting.
All in all, I don't think you did anything too terrible. It worked out in the end. We should just be more careful from now on. Don't dwell on it.
Yeah, you take the first one.
Yeah. Ollie, go ahead and make me a wisdom saving throw.
Okay.
Okay.
A natural 20.
Okay. You, as you're kind of contemplating what happened and you're kind of replaying it in your head, trying to figure out, because it seemed slightly out of place to you, some of the decisions that you made. And so you're kind of contemplating and kind of going over your thought process and everything, as you've done many times before. You know, the life of a cleric is very introspective, so you kind of rethink your decisions on a fairly regular basis just to keep yourself pious. This feels slightly different, and as you're doing it, your right arm begins to itch and burn slightly.
And so I look at the guy, look at everybody, and say, I have not been completely honest with everyone. Lillian knows of this, but I tried to hide it because I wanted to take care of it. I thought I could, but I can't. And I take off the bracer and I roll up my sleeve.
As the rest of you guys kind of look, you can see what almost looks like a cattle brand on his arm, of a symbol that you've never seen before. But it's deep, much, much deeper than any brand that you've ever seen, and it's very large, larger than really would be effective in a brand. And you also notice that, unlike a brand where it's basically it's scar tissue that makes the brand, this is jet black, almost like the skin has been charred instead of simply burned in the entire area. It almost has a shine to it.
Ollie, what is that?
This was, I guess you can call payment for Daggerford.
Wait, is that how I got out?
We were told to take care of... I've already forgotten his name.
Percival.
Percival, yeah, that guy. We were told to get rid of him. And I twisted the words and made it so we just took him away from Daggerford. We were told to kill him, but I did not. It is not right to kill an innocent person.
We should.
We didn't go to the deal.
I mean, it's how you shouldn't have. I just chugged the rest of my glass of wine. Ollie, you should have told me sooner.
I know. I thought I could handle it. But the Black Spire, is that what they were called? Black Spire? What I talked to?
Black Staffs.
Black Staff, yeah. We were in Black Staff. Remember when I was held back? She said that it is a very dark curse, and that essentially at any time my body will not be my own to control.
Well,
so
you're my friend, and even more so now that I learned that you kind of sold your soul to get me out of jail. So if there's anything you need.
You two are both followers of Eldath, right? Yes.
I am a new one, yes.
Yeah.
Altier, make me a wisdom saving throw.
Wiz save. 7.
So as you are kind of sitting there and talking to him, and it's starting to dawn, you start getting flashbacks to being in the jail cell and seeing that man come in who basically had your face. Like, he looked almost identical. And then watching your hand get closed around a dagger and then shoved into basically your own guts, and watching the light leave your eyes, you start to get this kind of sick feeling as you start to realize what was happening almost simultaneously with Ollie, as he was getting branded in order for you to be able to leave. And your vision starts to swim a little bit, and you kind of start to get a bit of a tunnel vision where the only thing that you can really focus on is Ollie's arm. And you're still having the conversation, but you can't take your eyes off it. And then you start feeling this overwhelming urge to touch it. And Ollie, you're kind of watching his speech start to slow a little bit, his words start to slur a little bit, and his eyes become unfocused, and he just starts looking at your arm, and you see him kind of reach out to touch it. What do you do?
I pull my arm back.
Okay. As you do that, make me a wisdom saving throw. Okay. As you sit there and you start to pull back, you feel a very strong urge that you shouldn't. It's not strong enough that it prevents it, but you just, from deep within your chest, you get this kind of warm sensation and this overwhelming urge to leave your arm where it is and to not pull it back. But it's not strong enough that it compels you to do it. What do you want to do? At this point, you've kind of got a tunnel vision as well. You don't really recognize that Enna or Liliane is there. The sounds of the tavern itself have stopped. Right now, in all of existence, it's really you and Altair. That's all you can really tell.
I'll listen to the feeling and I'll leave my arm on the table.
So Altair, as your hand comes in contact, it's like the world turns off. You guys are no longer in the tavern. Ollie, as you look around, you notice a very strange place that you've never been before. And you've been to a fair amount of places along the Sword Coast in your training and in your adventuring days. You've seen quite a few different places, and this is wholly unique. The air smells different. You can see buildings all around you, and you can see docks with ships in them. The city itself is one that you've never seen before, and it has almost a sickly sweet smell to it. Altair, you know exactly where you are. You've been here 100 times before. You can see your father's shop no more than about 200 feet away. You've smelled the sickly sweet scent of the various flowers and sweets and things that they put in a lot of the busier parts of Mulemaster to mask the smell of death. You start to realize that as much as this is Mulemaster, it's not exactly the Mulemaster you remember. And then you see a figure standing in the same spot she was standing in the last time you saw this. And she's about 100 feet away, and instead of just you being in here, and you can hear the cloaks and the commotion down in the Zent ghettos, just like before, but it's far away in the area that you're in. It's very calm and serene. And that woman is standing there. But this time, Ollie is standing right next to you. What do you guys want to do?
Yeah.
Ollie, you're completely perplexed. You've never seen anything like this before. You do see this woman standing in a glade that seems very out of place in a dock. You can see some trees, you can see some water. It looks like it doesn't fit there, but at the same time, it looks like almost like the docks grew around it. It's such a bizarre kind of juxtaposition of natural in the middle of the manufactured city that you're in. Beyond that, you have no idea where you are, but something about the figure who's a little bit too far away for you to make out features seems familiar and seems comforting, and you start to think back to when you were meditating in Valdis's house and the figure that was on the other side of the wall that reached through the wall and held you up. And this figure seems to be very similar, if not the same person.
Well, good thing I touched your arm, isn't it? Well, welcome to where I grew up. And I don't want to separate from him at this point because I don't know how this place works, so I just kind of grab the cloak he's wearing and I'm just like, just follow me. And I'm going to start walking us towards the glade.
So, Altair, as you start walking, the closer you get to this woman, the lighter your steps feel. You start to feel a warmer in your chest. You start to feel your limbs become stronger. It becomes easier and easier. The sounds of the fighting in the Zent ghettos are becoming harder and harder to hear. You feel the panic that was welling up as you heard the cloaks getting closer and closer and calling out to you start to subside and start to just kind of fade away into nothingness. Ollie, on the other hand, with every step closer to her, your arm starts to itch. And as you go 10 feet closer, the itching goes from a mild annoyance to something that's just borderline painful. You go 10 steps or 10 feet closer, and now it's starting to burn a little bit. And you go 10 feet closer, and your legs are getting heavy, and moving is taking much more effort. You take 10 steps closer, and the burning sensation on your arm has now erupted into full-blown pain. You're barely dragging your feet. You're starting to breathe heavily like you're fighting against a strong current of wind to walk here. Altair, you start to notice that your hand that's kind of guiding him is starting to get pulled back, and he's starting to slow down. And you look back at him, and he's breathing incredibly heavily. You can see beads of sweat forming on his brow. And you can see this staunch determination in his eyes, like he's enduring and fighting through something incredibly difficult.
Is he wearing armor in this form?
He wearing armor? Exactly as he did in the tavern. So the only thing he's not currently wearing is he has no bracer on his... It's your right arm or your left arm, Ollie?
Right arm.
Right arm. So there's no bracer on his right arm. Otherwise, he's in his full getup.
I see him like this, and I say, because you saved me back there, I have this gift, so now I'm going to help you, and I'm going to spend a key point to Fists of Life him, try and alleviate some of this.
Okay. As you sit there, and you feel the healing energies enter into your hands, as you try to take that energy and infuse it into Ollie, it doesn't work. You try as hard as you can, but the energy, almost like there's a barrier preventing it from going from your hands into his body.
Damn it. And because I'm feeling stronger with every step I take, I'm just going to like loop his arm around me, and I'm just going to say, come on, let's go.
Okay. Ollie, you have your arm around Altair's shoulders, which is unique in the idea that you're a human and Altair is a halfling. And despite his small size, you still feel this incredible strength beneath him, and just him kind of propping your arm up and kind of putting a hand around you and pulling you forward, you feel a little bit stronger. You can feel some of Altair's strength kind of bleeding into you. Again, you're about 40 feet away from the figure.
Let's keep going.
Yeah.
So you guys get going. Altair, you start to notice that with each step closer, his arm becomes heavier. He becomes larger. He becomes denser. It seems almost as if he's sinking into the ground itself, that he's becoming part of the stained and bloodied grounds that make up Mulmaster. You know that these streets have been stained by the blood of innocents for centuries. You know that this particular part of Mulmaster has seen more death and destruction than anyone would care to admit. And he seems to be becoming part of that, almost sinking into it. Ollie, as you move 10 feet more towards him, you cry out in pain, surprisingly, because the mark on your arm has now burst into actual flames. There's now smoke rising off of your arm, but you grit your teeth and continue to move forward. As you move another 10 feet, Altair, you can smell the sickening scent of burning flesh. That
we just have,
really
we just have to
returns your good. Stomach.
You just have to get to it, and I'm going to step of the wind to give us that extra boost.
Okay. You, Ollie, again, you feel your strength leaving you. It's becoming harder and harder. You start to doubt that you're going to be able to make it there. And then you suddenly feel, again, this kind of rush of strength emanating from Altair. As now he's stopped kind of helping you and is basically carrying you and pulling you the rest of the way. You get within 10 feet and Altair, you can see the face that you saw before reaching out, welcoming. You can see a smile there, and she's reaching out for your hand. Ollie, as you get closer, you see the figure you saw before, but you see tears in her eye, in her eyes, and this expression of pure sorrow as she reaches her hand out for you.
I'm going to, not just with my hand, but I'm bringing his hand with me as I grasp her hand.
Okay. Ollie?
I'll stick my right arm out.
Okay.
For her hand.
So as Altair, as you try and reach for it and get closer, suddenly you feel the ground beneath you shake and this massive wall bursts from the ground beneath you, knocks you to your feet. Knocks you to your off your feet, I mean. Make me a dexterity saving throw.
20 total.
The weird thing about this wall is it shoots up and it separates you and Ollie. Ollie, you've seen this wall before. You felt it before. You have cut your hands and your knuckles on it before. This is the wall that you saw when you were meditating at Valdis's house. The strange thing about it, though, is while the wall is rising, there is about a 1 foot wide section that stops because Altair now has you. He's grabbed your forearm with his hand, and you've kind of grabbed his in that kind of like manly handshake type thing, and the wall can't move past that point. So for the first time since meeting this wall, your arm, just your hand, has made it to the other side. And Altair, as you're sitting there, you're too far away from the figure. She's still 10 feet away. You're too far away to reach her hand without letting go of Ollie.
I look at her, I look back at Ollie, and I just shake my head and I'm just like, I'm not going there without you. You did this to save me. I can't. And I'm just going to try and keep tugging him forward, see if there's any way I can bring him up and over, or if I can just do anything.
So you start to feel like you're pulling against a statue. There's no give. There's no movement. You still smell that sickly scent of burning flesh from the other side of the wall. And then suddenly you feel a warmth on your shoulder. And you look up and the figure has come forward and placed her hand on your shoulder. And you both feel this very warming sensation pass through Altair into Ollie. And immediately the fire on your arm is extinguished. The mark is still there. It still hurts, but it's no longer burning the rest of your arm away. And as you're sitting there, Altair, you hear in the most melodic, beautiful sound you've ever heard in your entire life. You've heard it once before, the last time you were here. Ollie, this, as much as you've been a cleric your entire life, you've never heard this sound before, and it immediately brings you to tears. And without thinking, you immediately bow your head. And you hear the words, "My champion and my servant." She gestures first to Altair and then to Ollie. "You have many difficult trials ahead of you. What has happened is not something I will undo. A payment must be made. However, the sacrifice you have made, my servant, has brought my champion to me. For this, you shall be rewarded." And then the figure turns to Altair. "Champion, my servant cannot survive this on his own. He has interfered with powers beyond his comprehension. And my own duty, I am duty bound not to interfere. So I command you, my champion, protect him, aid him, and help him pay off the debt he has. This is your quest, your commandment from your master."
I nod my head and bow it a bit.
"My servant, you know my will much better than my new champion. You have learned to listen for my voice, and though this is the first time you have heard it audibly, you know what it is to listen. Your quest and your command is to lead my champion. Teach him my ways. Educate him. Do you understand?"
I look up, I shake my head, and I say, "Yes, I understand."
"What you are going to go through will test your faith more than anything you have ever dealt with. And for this, I am sorry. But with my champion's help, you can survive this. And you will learn things you never thought possible.
I will help him."
"Goodbye, my servant. Goodbye, my champion. Know that I watch over you both." And then you are back in the tavern.
I just look at Ollie in the eyes and I'm like, "She's pretty cool, huh?"
Henna and Lillian, as you guys are sitting there, you watched as Altair kind of went over and touched the mark and then immediately looked at Ollie and said, "She's really cool, isn't she?" And the whole thing looks weird. You notice that Ollie is sweating right now, which is weird because he wasn't like, this is like instant flop sweat.
I grab the bottle of wine, smell it, try to see if there's anything in it, and then take a swig, like see if anything happens.
There's half a glass left as you take a swig. It's pretty good. Like, you're impressed. You, with your natural background, you can tell that this was made from good grapes. It was fermented properly. Like, you're like, this is impressive. You weren't expecting that.
But not laced with anything.
No.
There's no psychedelic drugs in this.
Not that you can tell. All right. Like, the most psychedelic thing you've ever dealt with is mushrooms. So, you're not tasting anything, you know, fungusy about it.
All right. Set it back. Okay. So, what are we going to do about that? And I point to the mark.
And I as she asks, I'm covering it back up and putting the bracer back on.
I feel like it'll come to us. And Ollie, just know, be more open. I'm always willing to help.
I will definitely do that.
Have we tried casting Cure Wounds on it? I just kind of reach over.
I'm not sure that will work.
So I, like, reach my hand out to cast Cure Wounds.
Roll, go ahead and roll the healing.
Eleven.
I'll get two of that. Yeah.
And touch it, your hand burns, and you take 11 fire damage.
I didn't know that would happen. I thought nothing would happen, but now we know it's not a good idea.
Ollie, you feel strange. Because you feel almost as if you just cast inflict wounds. It's a very bizarre feeling because you didn't, but it still feels that way. You felt energy pulse out of you and into him.
Did I legitimately burn ki? Just question.
Yes, you did.
Well, Ollie.
Wow. Like, again, technically no time passed during that entire ordeal. So it's really bizarre, but you definitely feel that some of your key reserve has been used.
Alright.
Sorry. Well,
no, that's fine.
I'm thankful for the thought, though.
So, Ollie, this is something we'll deal with later, obviously, as we...
Yeah.
I just nod to him as, like, you're the vision, because I don't want to seem crazy anymore. So, I guess that means, well, we have to focus on what's at hand, then.
Yeah.
Focus
on the power of the is what happens with Holly happens with your time.
I would ask if it comes to it, since I don't know what this really curse does. If it comes to me, if I'm going to hurt one of you, just don't hold back.
Hmm.
Don't let me do that.
I don't say anything to that. I just pour myself my half glass of wine, because I only drank one, and I'm just going to start mulling things over in my head. Mix of the cultists, mix of the vision. Being called champion for the first time, and it feels weird.
Foldus, you seem awfully quiet. Don't you have any insight into this?
The rest of lunch passes uneventfully. It starts getting later, like midday. The cook comes out and starts telling you guys you need to leave because they've got to clean the tables and everything off, you know.
All right.
Dinner will be in a couple of hours.
Right.
As you guys are heading out, you notice that the large the rest of the cultists that came up with the caravan are preparing their horses and leaving.
Do they seem to have any containers with them?
Nothing but the packs on their back.
What about bodies?
You don't see any packages or anything that could be a body. You get the idea that they probably went and buried. While you guys were napping and everything, they probably went off and buried the bodies of their comrades.
Okay.
Can I look for a guy with a broken jaw?
Make me an investigation check. With disadvantage because they're kind of far away.
14. No. 15.
Looking around, you see a couple people whose faces have been rearranged. But as far as the specific guy that you broke his jaw, not seeing him. But half of them are wearing cloaks and have their backs to you. So.
Or a guy that's walking kind of funny.
Well, again, they're all riding at this point.
Yeah.
But you do notice one of them is riding very awkwardly. And seems to have extra padding on his saddle.
With like a bag of ice just always under him.
If there was ice, then yes.
Yeah. So, that's interesting. They did say they always left empty.
Well, and Colin did think that the goods were being used here. He thought they were bringing stuff for here, saying that they always left empty-handed. So either the goods are still here, or maybe they left with a different caravan.
I turn to Voldus and in halfling, I cast locate object.
I was just going to say, Voldus, can't you find the coin, see if any of them have it, or if it's...
That happened in the morning, right?
Yeah.
Pardon?
Locate object to 100 meters or 1,000 feet or something like that?
1,000 feet, 10 minutes long.
Okay. 1,000 miles. Looks at you guys and says it's... The coin is still in the... storehouse.
Okay. So then...
Almost directly below us right now.
Well, it's still here, maybe. I was thinking they might have...
Just whispering this to Valdis and Halfling so that people don't overhear us. I was thinking they might have sent it ahead of us. And then they were going to go beat it. Or maybe it's the other way around. They go first.
The only thing I can tell you is currently the coin that was supposed to be put with the other containers is where it's been this morning. Maybe we should something probably will check change that tomorrow, but right now it's still there.
Alright. What do the rest of you think? Well, I'm gonna start calling everybody back to our room so that we're not in the open anymore.
As you start heading to your room, a woman runs out and goes, "Excuse me, you only paid for one night. I need that key back."
Oh, very sorry. How much for another night?
Well, if you're going to be here for, we have a weekly rate. Probably save you a few copper.
How much?
It's 5 gold for the week. For the room.
I reach into my pocket, pull out 5 gold, and hand it to her.
Voltaire's money.
A Voltaire's money.
Yeah.
It's fine.
And she kind of looks at it and goes, "Right, you're paid up through the end of the week, then."
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And then she wanders. She kind of waddles off.
So once we're in the room, I'm just lock the door so that nobody comes in. I'm just like, so they may have not trusted us and not put the ring with where their stuff is. If they don't If they don't come back by tomorrow, we could try something here. We could try tracking them.
I think they trusted Voldis.
Because they thought he was stealing. Yeah, they thought he was stealing,
One of the cultists gave him a key. So it doesn't seem like they were, and told them about the plot, but it doesn't seem like they were distrustful of him. But well, maybe we should double check.
With Anna, as far as he knows, he feels that they believed him.
I had another idea. It is a little bit risky, but I think it might be beneficial if we sneak into the room where the containers are. If we can identify one or two of them, I could try leaving a message in Druidic to mark the crates, and then I would be able to spot that message.
Yeah, but would they be able to see the message?
If they're looking very closely. I did say it was risky.
As you guys are speaking, you start noticing that the weather outside has become much worse. The storm fronts.
Oh, those poor cultists getting rained on.
Wait, that was sudden. Does that seem natural?
It's been kind of overcast all day. And you guys have been holed up in a room with no windows for lunch and for cleaning and all that stuff. So it doesn't seem unnatural in the least. You just think that, you know, the stormfront finally got in and it started probably shortly before you guys got into your room, and it got heavy enough for you guys to notice while you were having a conversation. All
right. So we have the room as an option. We have actually seeing if their stuff is still there as an option. And then we have waiting to see if they return or if they don't following them.
Yeah, only a problem.
Is anyone trying to survive?
Survival.
I am.
Survival, I probably am.
I'm not.
Anna, you know specifically the rain. Lillian would know as well. the rain would make it incredibly difficult to track them unless you were actually following them now. Like, if you wait for a day, they're gone.
Yeah.
Like, you won't be able to track them unless you accidentally run into them in, like, water deep.
Yeah, we're going to stop them. We need to do it now.
But we're supposed to find out where the goods are going.
Yeah, we don't... They didn't go with them. So I think the priorities would be here.
You guys do know there was enough stuff that they brought. There is no possible way they could have shoved it all into their packs. Like, it's just...
Yeah. Right.
Physics-wise.
And they were heading...
would not be able to hold that much stuff.
And they were heading back south, right?
That's what you get. You don't really know, because technically there's only one route out of this work camp that heads back to the tradeway. So the most you know is that they're heading back to the tradeway. They could go to Neverwinter, they could go to Waterdeep. You know they're not going into the forest, they're sticking to the road.
I could try following them as far as the tradeway and just see if they go north or south.
I don't...
You're
but
again, about bare minimum day and a half, 2 days.
I don't, I don't think that's wise. Plus, from what we all faced in there, they're more or less grunts.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes, I mean, we did take out their leader. Or their best fighter, anyways. Again, I'm thinking we have to follow the goods.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I'd say room or storage room.
Well, I'm out of that. I'm not stealthy enough.
Right now, the storage room is not technically open, but is goods are regularly being put in there. As wagons are unloaded, as people that are staying for another night, they will give their valuables to Bogluck to put in there. So, as of right now, the room is technically open, or as open as it can be. It's being regularly used. Once everything shuts down for the night, then the room will be shut for the night, and it technically is not supposed to open until the next morning.
Do we see Bogluck constantly going in and out?
Yes.
It's not normal people can't go in there type of thing.
Yeah. The workers that are carrying boxes in can go in there because Bogluck is not going to carry the boxes himself.
Okay.
And, the people that give him their valuables, he takes their valuables and puts them in there himself. He doesn't let the people go in and put their valuables in because there's too much of a chance of someone palming something.
Right. I think if we're going to hit the safe room, the secure storage room, we'll have to do that under the cover of night.
Or could you both in and
I could sneak in as a spider.
What do you guys want to do? You have probably close to, I don't know, 2.5 hours before dinner's going to start. And basically, dinner is the end of the day. Once
what?
They'll do it in shifts. The workers will eat in shifts. Once the last shift is started dinner, they're done. Bogluck locks up the room. They close off the storage, the larger storage room. It's not locked, but they close the doors. And that's when, you know, people get out, you know, instruments, and you know, that's the nightlife at that point.
So we pretty much, do we think that all the cultists left?
All the ones that came with you, because again, they're all in peasant clothes, so theoretically there could be more cultists there, you wouldn't know them.
All right.
Like, you can't tell cultists, because they did, all the ones that came up with the caravan that you came up with, all shared two rooms, because they're too big for one. They shared two rooms. They intermingled with each other, so you that's how you were able to tell who the cultists were. But they also spoke to other people. And so did you. So theoretically, there could be cultists that were there before. More wagons came today. Technically, some of them could be cultists. You have no idea. What you do know is the people that came with you on the caravan are leaving today.
Okay.
Or rather, have just left.
It's
just an exchange of hands place.
My thought is that we try the room, but to try the room, I either need to be like have magic casted on me, or Valdis needs to go into his alternate identity again.
Yeah, but Valdis has already tried that.
Well, no, he's not going to be talking to Bogluck. He's going to be going to the room.
Yes, but unless he's one of the workers, they won't let him in.
Yeah. Not that room. Not that room.
Oh, the other room. Maybe. But what do we think we'll find in there?
Not sure.
I mean, if the cultists all left, then they would have taken everything with them.
None of these are like reserved, like you don't see big signs saying reserved for Cult of the Dragon members. These are, it's a hotel room. Anything
yes,
you... in there when it's, you know, cleaned as much as they might clean it. They leave valuables in there. The person cleaning it is probably pocketing them. So anything valuable is probably gone.
So good. Stolen would be probably our best bet. However, Valdis already finds out and Balrog that through him. So I'm thinking we have Ezra by the end because he left.
I don't think Bogluck's gonna let anybody in. Just look around.
And he's already, you know, I would feel bad. I've already made him go face Bogluck once, and I thought Bogluck was gonna throw him across the room. If I try to get him to go into more shenanigans for us, I don't think he'd be up for it.
Yeah. If anything. And it's like a spider or a pocket mouse and myself invisible with whatever that sound magic you do is.
Yeah.
So the secure room is under the kitchen, right? Or under the common room or whatever on the first floor?
Yeah, basically the common room and the kitchen are on the second floor, and what's directly beneath them are the storehouse and then the storage room.
I was going to say, where the kitchen would be. How close together are the floorboards there?
They're well made. You know, they're enough where you can have, you know, 40 or 50 people plus tables, chairs, and not have to worry about things breaking through.
More like small spider-sized holes or gaps.
In the roof, you would have a hard time finding something like that. You would have a much easier time finding a hole or a gap in the door itself than you would in the roof.
Okay. So, Altia, I could just turn myself into a spider. You sneak us in, slide me under the door. I can unbeast shape. Unlock it from the inside, maybe.
Or pick it.
Or just look around.
Yeah. But...
Valdis, who's the only one of you guys that's actually seen the room, pipes up at this point and says, it's a padlock.
I could turn into a bear and just cave the door in. Oh, no, that's probably going to be loud.
I see you, bear.
If you did that and you really somehow...
Cool, it's called a sword.
It's a padlock.
As good as my maul.
You know, that newfangled technology of padlocks down them.
Wait. I use produce flame to create a small little fireball in my hand. And say, well, I do have a lockpick of my own, but it is a little bit more severe. And then extinguish it.
I think kind of idea probably a bear is the one going.
Do we think I should mark the boxes, though? Assuming I can figure out which one are theirs.
If you can't track the mark, I don't think so.
I could at least... the idea is that maybe I could recognize it as... Or I could recognize the mark as the boxes are being loaded up onto another caravan.
A good idea would be... In case...
Of course, if somebody else is...
In case
they're really examining the box.
In case they didn't trust us, you could show something small to Valdis and plant that in the box that you think is theirs.
That could work as well.
That's what you guys did with the ring. Valdis kind of
popped. Yeah.
Up. He's like, that's what I did with the ring. Like, it's...
Shoot.
As far as I know, Bogluck believed me wholeheartedly because he chewed me out massively. For attempting to steal from just called them men. So the ring is in with the cultist goods, and right now that ring is still in that room.
If it changes,
I should be able to figure out when I locate object I can do it.
Alright.
Right.
I guess we should check out the room then.
All my spells, you know, fighting a pointless bar fight.
That was not pointless.
I mean,
well,
the bar fight was. The duel was not. It was self-defense.
So you guys have been mulling this over. About an hour and a half has passed. Even in your room with the door locked, you're starting to smell the beginnings of dinner.
Would this count as a short rest so that I could
spend
more? Thank you.
From trying to heal, you have to spend hit dice.
So, I mean, technically, short rest requires you to do light activity. Talking counts as light activity. So.
Okay. That's what I figured, but wanted to double check.
We can go eat.
The fact that it's getting late, okay. That's where we are going to end it for tonight. If this is your first time watching it, I am, I think, like two or three episodes behind right now because life has been very, very difficult recently, and I haven't been able to watch it anymore. But go to youtube.com/trainerjody. That's where. Previous episodes are, if you want to see other stuff, other crazy shit these guys have done. Follow me on Twitter. I'm Trainer Jody on Twitter. YouTube.com/TrainerJody, Twitch.tv/TrainerJody. It's just Trainer Jody with me. Except for this one woman who's a physical trainer in, like, California. And she took my name. other than that, like, I'm not a woman in California that's a physical trainer. So if you see that, that's not me. Anyway, guys, that's all for me for tonight. I'll see you guys next time, all right? Bye-bye!